honor you. We thank you for another time at your feet. We ask that you will speak forth expressly this morning. We ask, O God, that no man will come here and go back the same. King of glory, release unto us that which you have prepared for your people. Let me not speak of myself, but King of glory, we ask that you will speak to me and speak to us in the name of Jesus. Be thou exalted. We ask, O God, that burdens will be lifted today. Diseases will be taken away in the name of Jesus. Questions will be answered. In Jesus' name we pray. I'd like to welcome all of us to today, Sunday service. It has been a great time. We thank God for what he's doing. I'm glad, I'm excited to see more and more of us coming to worship. We started a series, and last week, Pastor took us through the topic. It's a series on faith. And last week it was fear versus faith. Today we are going to be looking at the topic, faith as a weapon. Faith as a weapon. And as a startup, we'll look at the words in that topic. Faith is absolute or total trust or confidence in God. Faith is absolute or total trust or confidence in our God. You may also define it this way. It is a strong belief in our Christian doctrine. A strong belief. Belief that is resolute. It doesn't waver. You don't change your mind. A strong, resolute belief in our Christian doctrine. And then I'd like us to look at the meaning of weapon. Weapon is something that you may use to inflict bodily harm or damage. Something you may use to inflict bodily harm or physical damage. But more relevant to our discussion is the definition of weapon, which says a means of gaining an advantage or defending oneself in a conflict. A means of gaining an advantage or defending oneself in a conflict. That's what a weapon is. I like to introduce this way by saying, brethren, that faith is a weapon of warfare. As believers, we are at war. The Christian race is a battle. The devil goes about fighting daily, and his primary goal, his primary aim, is to pull down believers. That's what he does daily. Goes about looking for whom he will pull down. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Technicals, I'll be happy if you follow me so that we'll be fast. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Scripture says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. This is his primary preoccupation. Moving around, looking for anybody that is unsuspecting to sweep him off, to devour that, such a believer. So we are at war daily. In the absence of faith, the believer is alone. There is no defense, and he is vulnerable. Bearing in mind that we are at war, like we have established, in the absence of faith, a believer is alone, is not protected, he is defenseless, and so he becomes vulnerable and becomes a tool readily in the hands of the devil. It's important for us to state here that this battle before us is not conventional. It's not the conventional type of battle, so it's not physical. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12, scripture says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So it's not a conventional type of war. It is a spiritual battle. Like we have read, the battle that we are fighting is not flesh and blood, but it's against principalities. It's against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. But God has not abandoned us. He has not left us without a defense. God has not left us without a defense. In Hebrews chapter 4 verse 15, in Hebrews chapter 4 verse 15, scripture says, "For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin." So Jesus was here. He passed through all of this, and he understands the challenges before us. He understands the type, the nature of the battle. So it's not a battle he has not been involved in. And so he's just telling us it is a battle he too was privy to. And so he feels us. He understands the pain, our challenges, what we are going through. And so that's the reason why it is his preoccupation to train us, to equip us, and make sure we are ready for this battle. In 2 Samuel chapter 22 verse 35, 2 Samuel chapter 22 verse 35, scripture says that this is what Jesus, this is what God does for us. He teaches my hands to war, so that a bowl of steel is broken in my arm. This is what God does. He teaches us. He understands the challenges we are facing. He understands perfectly the war before us, the battle, the challenge before us. And so he prepares us for this battle. Scripture says here, as we have read, that he teaches my hands to war, so that a bowl of steel, as strong as it is broken in my arms. Again, in Psalms chapter 144, Psalms 144 verse 1, in Psalms 144 verse 1, 144 verse 1, scripture says, "Blessed be the Lord, my strength, which teacheth my hands to war. Blessed be the Lord, my strength, which teacheth my hands to war, and my fingers to fight." This is not a physical fight, brethren. This is the battle in the Christian race, contending for our faith. As the fight is not physical, brethren, so the weapons of our warfare are equally not physical. So it's not knife and gun that we are using to fight this battle. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 3, 2 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 3, scripture says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh." The next verse, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds." So the weapons that we are using for this battle, like I said, it's not knives. Scripture says that in verse 4 of this 2 Corinthians chapter 10, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds." Apostle Paul admonishes us in Ephesians chapter 6, beginning from verse 13. Ephesians chapter 6, beginning from verse 13. He understood also the battle before us. And so he recommended that we put on the whole Christian armor. Scripture says in verse 13, Ephesians chapter 6, "Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day." Not just to withstand, but after you have done everything, that you will still be standing. After you have done everything, that you will still be found faithful. Next verse, verse 14. Scripture says, so he went into the specifics. He says, "Stand therefore, having your loins get about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness." The next verse, verse 15. "And your feet shod with the preparation for evangelism." And then he went to verse 16 and he says, above all, after you have done all this, above all of this, taking the shield of faith. So scripture describes faith as a shield. "Taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked." Verse 17. "And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God." Verse 18. "Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints." Praise the Lord. So, above all, verse 16, above all, taking the shield of faith. It means that the shield of faith is critical, is crucial. If you take a look at this whole armor, you will notice that the shield of faith, the shield for a soldier, is like a backup. It's like an extra cover, an extra protection. Having worn the helmet, having worn the breastplate, having girded the loins, you still require a shield of faith, like a backup, still protecting the chest that is already protected by the breastplate, still protecting the loins, still protecting the head. So it means that faith is critical in our Christian walk. Faith is critical in our Christian walk. Very quickly, I'd like us to look at a few truths concerning faith. We'll look at five truths concerning faith as a weapon of warfare. We'll look at five truths as it regards to concerning faith as it regards to being a weapon of warfare. The first one is that faith is real. Sometimes it seems as if faith is abstract, something that you need to explain and make people understand. But brethren, I like to tell us today that faith is tangible. Faith is real. 1 John chapter 1 verse 1. 1 John chapter 1 verse 1. Apostle John was talking regarding the doctrine of our Lord Jesus Christ. He was making a comment regarding Jesus himself, the word of life. Jesus is the word of life. He was talking concerning the doctrine we have received, the faith that we believe in. And so in 1 John chapter 1, scripture says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, we heard of it, which we have seen with our eyes. We didn't just hear, we saw it. For him, it was real. He said, which we looked upon. We didn't just see from a distance. We took our time. We looked upon it. And our hands have handled it of the word of life. Concerning this doctrine that we believe in, concerning this faith that is our foundation. He said it is real. It is tangible. We handled it. We touched it. Our faith is real. It's tangible. Perhaps that's why our fathers of old were prepared to die for it. Not many people will die for what they are not sure of. They must have been sure. They saw it. They handled it. Number two, faith is a shield. As it relates to faith being a weapon, I'd like us to know, number two, that faith is a shield. It's a cover. It's the protection of the believer. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 16. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 16. Faith is the covering a believer receives because he trusts God. That is the protection that we receive. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 16. Scripture says, above all, taking the shield of faith, wherein ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. The devil literally wants to clamp down on our salvation and strangle it out of us. That is his desire. He literally wants to pounce on us, strangle us, until our salvation is milked out of us. That is the devil's desire. But what happens? God has given us a shield, the shield of faith, that we will use to deflect all the missiles that come from the devil, all the fiery darts, all the arrows that the devil throws at us. So faith is a shield. It is the protection. It is the cover over the believer. I would say here that perhaps it is the greatest component of the Christian armor. Perhaps that's why it says above all, having done all the other ones, above all, you require the shield of faith. Above all, after you have used the helmet, after you have used the breastplate of righteousness, and beyond all this, you need the shield of faith. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6, the popular scripture we know, it says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that must come to him, he that cometh to him, must first believe that he is, that there is a God, and that this God will compensate you if you live right, if you please him, if you live for him. That's what scripture says. So it's basic. Before you can even relate with him, before you can come to him, you know, you must first believe that there is such a God, and that that God rewards every man who will live righteously, who will please him. You must believe. So it's basic. It appears to be, perhaps, like I said, the greatest amongst the Christian armor. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 2. Scripture says that our fathers of old, because of this faith, God was happy with them. They had their shortcomings. They made some errors. Abraham made his errors. You know, Jacob, all of them. They had their shortcomings. But because they trusted God, because they held fast on the promises of God, God counted it for them as righteousness. God was happy with them. Scripture says in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 2, for by it the elders of old obtained a good report. Even if they had their shortcomings, we know the shortcomings of Abraham, Father Abraham, and the other fathers of old, our other patriarchs of old. But because they held on to the promises of God, because they held firm and strong in faith, God counted it for righteousness. God was excited. God was happy with them. God overlooked their faults. So faith is therefore critical in the Christian walk, like I said earlier. Perhaps that's why, no matter the works you do, no matter the good works, if it is not founded upon faith in God, it is a waste. Scriptures will regard it as the righteousness of men. If whatsoever you are doing, it is not because of the confidence that you have in God, it is not because of the reverence you have for Jesus, then that is counted as filthy rags, the righteousness of men. So it is critical, faith in God, to our Christian walk. Number three, I like to say number three truth concerning faith, particularly as it refers to, in regards to being a weapon, is that Jesus is the source. He is the originator of faith. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2. Jesus is the source. All faith comes from him. Scripture says in Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Looking unto Jesus, the source and the perfecter of our faith. It is from him that all faith comes. Scripture says that who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, forgetting about the shame. And today we know what has happened. He's been exalted. He saw the glory ahead of him. He saw the honor that was to come. And so he was prepared to endure the cross. He was prepared to set aside the temporary shame, because he saw the glory that was to come. That is why he is our perfect example. That is why Jesus is our perfect example. In 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 1. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 1. Simon Peter here talking says, Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ. Now talking to those that he's writing to, he said to them that have obtained like precious faith. He's writing to people who have obtained this same faith that we also have, that is talking about himself. So it means that this faith is received. It doesn't just come. You receive it. You obtain it. It comes from Jesus. It comes from our God. So Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. So it's something we receive. It's something we'll appropriate. It's something God gives to us at our salvation. I will say here that, permit me to say, that faith is God's weapon of warfare. So he gives it to us to assist us in this battle in our Christian race. I will equally say that Jesus is the embodiment of faith. Romans chapter 4, verse 17. Romans chapter 4, verse 17. Scripture says, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations. Talking about Abraham. Before him, whom he believed, that is God, who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things that be not as though they were. So for him, everything is about faith. Let there be light. Whatsoever is not there, let there be light. There will be light. Everything about him is faith. Things that are not in existence, he calleth upon them, and they come to pass. So he said, our God is the God that calleth those things that do not exist. He talks about them as if they are already in existence. It's not as if he is telling the things to come into existence. He talks about them as though they were already in existence. You and I know that the world that we stand on, we are framed from the word of the mouth by God's commands. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 3. Hebrews 11, verse 3. Scripture says, true faith, we now understand that the words were framed by the word of God, so that things which we see now were not made from cement and sand. The things that we see, they were not made from the things that are seen. They were brought from the impossible, from nowhere they came to be. Okay, let me take us back. Jesus, when he was speaking at the death of Lazarus, look at what Jesus said, that statement, in John chapter 11, verse 43. You know, after all the engagement, he came, Jesus wept and so on, after all the discourse between Jesus, Mary, and Martha. In John chapter 11, verse 43, scripture says, and when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, comfort. You know, it is somebody that is alive that you ask, you tell to come. Somebody has to be alive before you say, please come, let's take a walk. Lazarus that was dead, Jesus was not saying, Lazarus, come back to life. He bypassed that stage. He said, Lazarus, comfort. So, I mean, that explains what scripture says. When he says that our God called those things that are not in existence, things that be not, somebody who is not even alive, he is telling the person, come. He called those things that be not, as if they were already there. So for him, Lazarus was not dead. Don't forget, that was what he said earlier. When they told him Lazarus is dead, he said, Lazarus is not dead. He said, Lazarus, comfort. He bypassed that stage, or that stage of saying, Lazarus, comfort out of death. Rise up from death. Then, I mean, that's the natural sequence. You cannot say, Lazarus, then come forth. He bypassed that one. For him, Lazarus was not dead. Lazarus was alive. That is the God we serve, an embodiment of faith. He called those things that are not even in existence, as if they were already there. Number four, faith is personal. This faith as a weapon is personal. No soldier goes to war and his plan is to share the shield. How are you going to do that one? The shield, it is one per person. No soldier goes to war and the plan is, you know the way you used to do it in those days. If maybe your Bible is bad, you tell your friend in school, students, please, then we'll share. If you write small, you give me. You know, sometimes when your Bible disappoints in the middle of nowhere, this does not happen like that. Faith is personal. You have to have your shield of faith. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. You know, that means that the bishop, it is his faith he will use, his shield of faith. The bishop's first son will have to get his shield of faith. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4 says, behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his own faith. You cannot, it's not possible for you to live by your pastor's faith or by your father's faith. So if somebody's father is a bishop, that bishop will live by his faith. And the bishop's child will have to live by his own faith. So everybody must get his faith, his shield of faith. It is a personal matter. Finally, on the five truths I want us to look at concerning faith as a shield, as a weapon. Faith is given to enable us to live a victorious Christian life. Faith is given to enable us to live a victorious Christian life. Now, looking at why God has given us faith. Many times when we hear of the word faith, what comes to mind is working of miracles. You have faith. You can tell, even if your faith is as small as that of a mustard seed, you can tell the mountain be removed, and you know, and so on. So we always consider working of miracles. But I'd like to let you know that is just a small part of the process of living the victorious Christian life. It's just a small part of it. It's bigger than that. Faith has been given to us that we will be able to live the victorious Christian life. I'll give a few examples. Challenges will come in life. Scripture says so. Challenges will come. Offenses will come. There will be challenges. There will be issues. There will be challenges in life. You can't escape it. But when during the period of challenges, that is when you know whether you have this faith. It is a true test of our faith. God made a promise to Abraham, and then decades started passing. But it was his faith that kept him. He remained firm on the promises of God. Faith kept him. Some of us, God has made a promise, you know, and he will fulfill it in his time. And it's 2 months, 6 months, 1 year. We're already tired. This God self, you know what I'm saying? It is faith that keeps us in the times of adversities. Joseph did not automatically become prime minister after 3 months. There was a process. There were challenges. But he stood firm. He did not compromise himself. He did not try to help God. He remained firm. In the times of adversity, in the times of challenges, that is the true test of our faith. That is why faith is given, that we may be able to overcome in times of adversities. Job had lost everything. Job lost everything. And people were telling him, what is remaining? You curse God and die. Job remained firm in faith. He stood on the promises of God. He knew the God that he had believed. This is the reason why faith is given. The primary reason. To enable us live a victorious Christian life. It is good to work miracles. But like I say sometimes, Lazarus was brought back to life. But where is Lazarus? I'm sure he must have died again, isn't he? So it therefore means that what is paramount, what is most important, is living a life that pleases God. Is living a victorious Christian life. A life that at the end of the day, like Apostle Paul will say, we will overcome and we will still be standing. That is why grace is given, primarily. Jesus, when the devil confronted him with the temptations, it was faith. Focus on his purpose. Faith on the reward that was to come. That was what kept him. You know, at Gethsemane, the devil laid down the template of the challenges in front of him. The shame he was to suffer. The pain that was to come. It is faith, confidence in the crown that was ahead. For scripture says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, because of the joy that was ahead, because of the glory, the crown that was in front, he endured the pain. Because of the faith, the confidence he had, that there was glory ahead of him, that was what kept him. So faith primarily is given to enable us live a life that pleases him. To enable us live a life that God will be happy with. So anytime one is puffed up in pride, you need to look at your faith again. Anytime you have pushed and forced to do evil, you need to look at your faith again. Because if you have confidence, you trust this God that he will reward your good works, and you equally trust that he will come again, you will watch your steps. So faith is critical to leading the victorious Christian life. People go astray because they have lost faith. People go astray because they are no longer sure that this God will still come. You understand what I'm saying? That's the issue. So faith is critical. We'll move on now, wrapping up, how to strengthen our faith. How do we strengthen our faith in the midst of all of this? The first is that before you start strengthening faith, you need to have the faith. So you must accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. For in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6, like we saw before, the faith is the starting point. Without that faith, you cannot even come to him. We must accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Number two, we must ask God. We must ask of the Lord. We must ask this faith of the Lord. Luke chapter 17 verse 5, scripture says, the apostles now talking. They said, and the apostles said unto the Lord, increase our faith. Are you there? Let's start from verse 1 of that Luke. This is very important. This is key. Because most times faith is mentioned. People think that if you have big faith, then you can lay hands on somebody, the person will recover. You can tell somebody to rise up from the dead. Yes, that is true. But what is more critical in the first instance is to be able to, that faith has been given to us to be able to live right. Let's start from verse 1. Luke chapter 17. Are you there? If this is the only thing we get today, I'll be happy. Luke chapter 17 verse 1. He said, then, because Jesus, it was not talking about a miracle, this instance. Then said he unto the disciples, it is impossible that offenses will come. Sorry, it is impossible, but that offenses will come. But woe unto him through whom they come. Next verse. It were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and he cast into the sea than that he should offend one of these little ones. Next verse. Take heed to yourselves. If thy brother trespasses against thee, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. Next verse. And if he trespass against thee 7 times a day, if he offends you 7 times a day, and 7 times in a day, turn again to thee, saying, I repent, thou shalt forgive him. It was after Jesus said this one. The disciples said, hey, who can do this? Next verse. That was when they said, and the apostle said unto him, increase our faith. With it, somebody slaps you 7 times and he says he's sorry. You say, okay, no problem. He said, increase our faith. That is, help us, give us the faith to be able to live aright, to be able to walk according to how God will expect us to walk. That's what scripture is, not healing, raising the dead or healing the sick. So this is the first reason why primarily faith was given, that we may be able to live according to how God will want us to live. So we must ask of him to give us faith. So we are wrapping up now. In Mark chapter 9, verse 24. You know, the man who brought his son. The son was taken, was possessed by a strange spirit. Brought him to Jesus. And so Jesus told him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to them that believe. That's in verse 23. Mark chapter 9, verse 23. In verse 24. And straightway, the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. But doubt, not let me see road. Help my unbelief. That's what he said. I beget faith. But doubt, not let me. Help my unbelief. We must come to God and plead for faith. Number 3, we must study God's word. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. He says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And finally, the 4th way that we can increase our faith, that we can strengthen our faith, is to exercise our faith. We must put it into exercise. In Hebrews chapter 5, verse 13 to 14, scripture says in verse 13, for everyone that useth milk is unskillful. It's a child, it's a baby, it's less than 2 years. Anybody that is still sucking milk, breast milk. But in verse 14, scripture says that but strong meat belongeth to them that are full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Brethren, wrapping up, faith is indispensable in the work of a believer. Faith is a weapon of war. Every believer must have it. You cannot share another person's own. You need this faith to be able to walk with God, to be able to live the victorious Christian life. I'd like you to consider your life. I'd like you to reflect and take a look at your life. We are going to be praying just 1 or 2 prayer points now, and then we'll wrap up in the next 2-3 minutes. You're going to ask yourself, how small is my faith? You need this faith to be able to walk with God. Without the faith, there is no basis for discussion. There is no basis for coming to God. That is basic. It is sacrosanct. And here are the disciples who have walked with Jesus for a while. When Jesus told them, the way I expect you to live your life, the way God expects you to behave, they realized that they were yet to start. And they said, God, Father, Jesus, increase our faith. Help us. So I'd like you to stand with me and close your eyes and talk to God. Convert it to prayer. Tell him, Father, help my unbelief. Jesus, increase my faith. Beyond the faith to lay hands on the sick to recover, I'd like you to trust God for the faith to live aright. The faith to believe his promises concerning you. I'd like you to trust him for faith. Faith to obey God. Faith to do his will. Faith to live according to his precepts. It is when you trust him, when you believe in what he is capable of doing, that's when you will humble yourself and obey him and follow his precepts. I'd like you to trust him for faith. Father, increase my faith. Help my unbelief. In the name of Jesus, King of glory, I ask that you will bestow upon me that faith. That faith that humbles a man. That faith that enable a man to obey you, to please you, in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. I do not know what challenges you are facing. I do not know that promise that God has made to you that appears to be delaying. I'd like you to call upon God and tell God, because he has spoken in his word that even if your faith is as small as that of a mustard seed, you are able to tell this mountain be removed. I'd like you to commit it to him. You are the one who knows where it pinches you. Tell him, God, let this mountain be removed. Tell him, God, let this mountain be removed. I'd like you to open your mouth and talk to God. Father, remove this mountain. You know where it pinches your people. King of glory, I ask that you will visit every man with a miracle. In the name of Jesus. King of glory, I ask that you will give me a touch. Give me a touch. Give your people a touch. In the name of Jesus. That touch that changes everything. That touch that changes everything. In the name of Jesus. We give you praise. We bless your name. We give you honor. We worship you. Join me singing.
Thou, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory, the lifter of my head.